each and every one of us today as he speaks to us his word. Amen. And so the word of the Lord today is Jesus is calling your name. Jesus is calling your name. The commands are clear. Jesus is calling your name. The commands are clear. And today the scripture is taken from 1 Corinthians 16, 13 to 14. And it's from the English Standard Version. And it says, be careful, be watchful, stand firm in the faith, act like men, be strong, and let all that you do be done in love. Be watchful, stand firm in the faith, act like men, be strong, and let all that you do be done in love. So the word is Jesus is calling your name. The commands this morning is they're clear. The commands are clear. They're clear because it's more than one. The commands are clear this morning. Let's pray. Father, I just want to thank you for your love this morning. I thank you, Lord God, for your download, and I thank you for your word that is already sent, Lord, this morning. Father, I pray that as your people hear your word, they will apply it unto their heart, Lord God, and they will be transformed and renewed for your glory, for your betterment, Lord, for their betterment, Lord. This morning, I pray, Lord God, that as your word, Lord God, is outlined, Lord God, they will apply it unto their lives and they will be transformed and renewed and recharged for your glory this morning. I pray, Almighty God, Lord God, that as your word is infused in us and through us, Lord God, we will see the transformation and we will be energized, Lord God, to run this race with vigor and with power and with might. So, Lord God Almighty, as your word is broken this morning before us, Lord God, I pray that we will eat our portion, Lord God, and we will, hallelujah, mount up, Lord God, this morning. And we will, Lord God, do thy will, and we will obey your word this morning because your word is active and your word is true. Ah, glory be to Yahweh. So, Lord, speak, Lord, because your servants hear it this morning as we magnify and glorify your name. And we say, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the blessed Holy Ghost. And we say amen and amen because it is so. So the word is this morning, be watchful, stand firm in the faith, act like men, be strong, and let all that you do be done in love. 1 Corinthians 16, 13 to 14. So these are five laser focused closing commands. And in order to be and to give clear commands, you must be laser focused as it brings order out of chaos. I want to repeat that again. You must be laser focused when clear commands is given because it brings order out of chaos. All the great commanders have been able to do this. Napoleon was known for this as he was keeping four secretaries going at once. Just the ability to give sharp, decisive, even detailed commands, it requires to be laser focused. But none of these men can come close to the clarity of the Holy Spirit. And so, operating through the Apostle Paul to give clear commands to God's people that are transcultural, that lasting in every generation all over the world, it brings order out of chaos in order to be laser focused. So, the commands of God, these five short, clear, and sharp commands, is to every generation of Christians. It was not just for the church in the early times, it's still for us today. And so, as we look at verses 13 and 14, to be watchful, stand firm in the faith, act like men, be strong, and let all what you do, be in love. These commands sum up what Paul wants to say to this dysfunctional, messed up Corinthians church. And I think we're earning the right to say that, because this was a dysfunctional, messed up church. Not trying to be insulting and not trying to say we're any better, because I hope that we are better because we have learned from the past. But we see sometimes we often forget. It was dysfunctional and messed up as we were seen, as we have seen across 1 Corinthians in this chapter, beautifully written and laid out. And it was written with fractions and division. It was immature, it was worldly, it was carnal, acting like babies. They were yearning for the approval of the world in very inappropriate ways. There were rifts with sexual immorality, and even a kind that doesn't occur among pagans. There were a lot of stuff going on. And they were unwilling to exercise church discipline. They struggled with temple prostitution or dealing with going to temple prostitutes. Christians were taking other Christians to court because those Christians had defrauded them in business. They had improper views of marriage and of singleness. They had problems with meat sacrifice to idols at several levels. They had problems with the Lord's Supper. They had problem with spiritual gifts. They gave primacy to certain gifts. My God, and they had fundamental problems loving each other. They didn't love each other as they should have. And some were even saying that resurrection from the dead couldn't occur and does not occur. And in all of this, they were forgetting the two reasons why God leaves all Christians on earth. The internal journey of holiness and external journey of witnessing to the lost souls, they forgot about that. They weren't doing those things as they should have. What a terrible mess that I just laid out to you. It was terrible all around. That's why I call them the dysfunctional church. And God, the Holy Spirit, addressed their dysfunctionality in a timeless way through 1 Corinthians. And it took the second epistle, 2 Corinthians, to continue to address the problem in this church. As Paul, the apostle, speaking under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, addresses these problems, he gives 5 sharp, clear commands. Be watchful. Stand firm in the faith. Act like men. Be strong. And let all that you do be done in love. Today, it's still the same. It's still the same commands. God didn't give commands for one generation. He gave it over and over and over again. Because there's a repeat offender of things that happens. So God is repeating himself. Be watchful. Stand firm. In the faith, act like men, be strong, and let all that you do be done in love. So the first command this morning is be watchful. This is a call to be vigilant in the Christian life. It implies danger, even a danger that comes unawares, or perhaps even things that creeps up on us. It implies danger by implying other things that call for watchfulness as well. It implies waiting and persevering watchfulness. And the contrast perhaps could be sleepiness or slumber. So a sentry standing watch throughout the night during wartime can be executed for falling asleep at the post. Why is that? The fate of the whole army is in the hands of watchful soldiers. That's why the first song was, He's calling my name. Oh, Jesus is calling my name. as he calls my name, I will answer a billion times. So the fate of the whole army is in the hands of watchful soldiers. And if the soldiers are tired, the soldiers are vulnerable to attack and death. So they have to stay awake through the night. It's vital. So spiritual drowsiness is a severe problem in Christianity today. We're drowsy. We're not watchful. And there's a kind of fog, a spiritual fog, that fills our mind and causes us to underestimate the circumstances that we're in. But we don't examine everything. We fly off on a whim. We don't connect the dots as we should. There's a spiritual fog that fills our mind and causes us to underestimate the circumstances that we're in. So physically and spiritually, we're in a fog. We don't really see what's happening. And the circumstances around us, we don't understand it. So therefore, we're in a daze. And a fog can come in and we can get sleepy or drowsy and just totally miss what's happening. And I see that in my own life and I see it in others. So I know that this is real because we're not being watchful. And I see that in Christianity today and throughout the body of Christ, there's a spiritual drowsiness that underestimates the dangers of the day because we're not being watchful. The worldliness is creeping in. And I see that more and more. There's more happening in the church that is pulling on the world, especially in the American Christianity world. I don't know about other countries because I'm not there, but I see what's happening in my backyard. I see it. It has the effects of dulling our senses and we're not sharp anymore. There's hardening of our hearts. And we have a tolerance now. I tolerate everything and anything. And everything is becoming okay with things that the Bible screams out against. That is the drowsiness that we're in because we're not being watchful. So therefore it becomes a gap between the language of sharp warning in the Bible and the way we're living and thinking about these things. We're compromising. We're sleepy. We're drowsy. So the Bible calls on us, not just here, but in many places, to be watchful and vigilant and not drowsy. We're taking our eyes off of the prize. When the Bible clearly commands us to be watchful. So what are we supposed to watch for? Because in the moment of being drowsy, I said we're vulnerable. In the moment of being, you know, drowsy, you're sleepy. You're not at your best. And therefore danger lurks and it creeps in. So what are you supposed to be watching for? Watch for Satan and his demonic cohorts. 1 Peter 5 and verse 8 says, be self-controlled and alert. You see, the Bible knew that all of these things would occur to us. So it's warning us, be self-controlled and alert. Your enemy, the devil, prowls around like a roaring lion seeking someone to devour. He's seeking you and I, that when we are vulnerable, he creeps in undetected, unannounced, because our guards were not up. Our gates were not fortified. We weren't watchful. We weren't mindful because we took our eyes off the prize. Now imagine for a moment going to a safari out in a lion country, out in Africa somewhere. And you're out there and you decide to to sleep under the stars. And so you're going to take a nice blanket and you spread it out on the grounds. And you're relaxing with all of your guards down. This is a safari. Would you do that? Would you do that? And I want you to picture that this morning. Get that image in your mind. You're in a safari, and for some reason or the other, you decide that you want to lay out a picnic blanket, and you just want to lay out there and look up into the stars because the African stars are just majestic and beautiful. But not realizing that you're in an African safari with dangerous animals lurking around. But because you want to capture the majestic wonders that exist underneath the African scenery, you said, I want to do this. But do you realize where you are? That's the question. Is that the right time to roll out a blanket and lay down in the midst of the lion den? Do you understand that lions are nocturnal? Do you have a sense that they might be interested in you for their meal for the night? Well, that's the picture of how some Christians are. They're spiritually unaware, they're not self-controlled and alert. They don't understand that their enemy, the devil, is prowling after them, looking for someone to devour. That 600-pound beast that decides to devour you. That's the image I want you to have in your mind. Think about the safari and think about the enemy on the other side. Because sometimes, because we've never seen the enemy, we don't know and we underestimate the capabilities of the enemy. So therefore, we have this nonchalant attitude about how we will understand what the enemy is capable of doing. But this morning, I want to put the safari in your mind. A visual example, would you? In a lion's den, roll out a blanket and just cut your tent and begin to look up into the African stars. No, you wouldn't. You're in the lion's den. Then why would you, in your daily walk with God, put down your guard where the enemy can creep in unannounced and destroy and devour you? So Paul says we ought to be aware, not unaware, aware of Satan's schemes. He said that in 2 Corinthians 2 and 11, in order that Satan might not outwit us, for we are not unaware of his schemes. Are you aware? So think of a scheme. I want you to think of a scheme this morning. A scheme is an evil plot, an evil plan. There's an intelligence and a dark intelligence to it, a combination of things that lead to your demise, to your sin. They are schemes. It leads to your destruction, your demise. And the Bible says, in order that Satan might not outwit us, for we are not unaware of his schemes. We must be on alert. We must be watchful. We need to be aware of it. So watch in reference to Satan and his demons. Jesus said to his disciples to watch and pray. To watch and pray. Do you remember how he was praying in Gethsemane? Do you remember? Jesus was pouring out his heart in prayer as he was getting ready to die for us. And then Peter, James, and John were with him. And then the other disciples were a little further off. And in Matthew 26 and 41, he says, watch and pray. So that you'll not fall into temptation. Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, But the body is weak because Satan's coming at you. He's speaking specifically to Peter, who was about to go through the worst night of his life. He was going through the worst night of his life, and he was unprepared. He was not prayed up because he wasn't watching and praying. So the question is asked this morning, what about you? Are you watching and praying? Or are you just assuming Satan's not going to come after you? Because many of us don't believe this Satan thing. Oh, yeah? I'm serious. Many of us don't believe this Satan thing. No, Satan's not busy with me. Okay, so here's the question. If Satan is not busy with you, then you are his. That's the flip side of that question, is that if you think Satan is not barking up your tree, then you already belong to him and he's not concerned about you. But when you don't belong to Satan, then he's coming after you because he wants you by any means necessary. By any means necessary. So are you watchful and praying? So if you consider yourself this morning a child of God, Satan is coming after you. It's not an if and or maybe. If you at all consider yourself to be a child of God this morning, you are Satan's target. You are his bullseye, and he's coming after you. So are you watchful and praying? Paul said to Timothy in 1 Timothy 4, verse 16, watch your life and your doctrine closely. Persevere in them, because if you do, you will save both yourself and your hearers. What does that mean? Watch your lifestyle. What habits are you in? What are your patterns? What are you doing now consistently? Because there are good and bad habits that we have. Are you in some bad habits that are overtaking your good habits? You gotta watch it. What's happening in your life? Watch it closely. Are you letting worldliness affect the way you see your Christian walk? Again, I say, watch your life. Are you drifting away from God? And there's another image in Hebrews 2, verse 1 that said, we must pay more careful attention, therefore, to what we have heard, so that we do not drift away. Is there a process of drifting going on in your life where you are further away from Jesus than you were before? Are you drifting away? Further and further away? As he said to the church of Ephesus in Revelation, you have forsaken your first love. Do you love Jesus a little less now than you did a year ago or 5 years ago? Are you drifting away? You gotta watch yourself. This is the beginning of the year. We're now in the second month. We can't do the same old that we did last year. And God is creating many ways and means to connect into Him. And yet, still, we don't do what we ought to do. So the question stands, are you drifting away? Because now he's created so many means and ways of hearing the word. And this remind me of last week on one of our platform morning session when, we were, again, we get together at 6:30 in the morning, and I tell you the amazing things that happens and how people really release and connect in. And the young lady said, I don't read the Bible as I ought to. And we all said, but there's audio Bible. There's audio Bible, people. So if I can't physically pick it up, what I choose to put in my ear, like we all walk around with our earbuds all day long. What are you listening in the earbud? What is on your playlist? Why can't it be a chapter a day that keeps the enemy away? That keeps your spirit revived and recharged? Because hearing the word is not for the flesh, it's for the spirit. It's to build the spirit, man. So we made that recommendation to her. I said, listen to the audio Bible. If you can't physically pick up the book, grab a hold of the audio Bible, turn it on, put the earbuds in as you're working, because we all got to do this thing called life. So while you're there working, you're listening because your spirit man is receiving. So when I talk about, are you drifting? What are you doing? Because God is creating means and ways to connect in. This morning, we're all in our various locations online, and still people aren't connecting in. Because there was a time when we all went to the physical brick and mortar. Sun, rain, snow, whatever, blizzard, we're going. And now you can't even get them to go to the physical building, let alone online. Because we're not being watchful anymore. We're letting the things of the world creep in. And just like what? You know what's said to the church in Ephesus and Revelation? You are forsaking your first love. Do you love Jesus a little less now than you did a year ago or 5 years ago, 10 years ago? Did your love dwindle? Are you drifting? The command this morning is saying, be watchful, watch yourself. Because we ought to watch over one another. We're supposed to watch each other. It's not just about am I drifting, but it's my brother drifting. Pull up your brother, pull up your sister this morning. And we're calling on each other to do that for each other. That's why one of our tenets is servant's heart is on display, being our brothers and sisters' keeper, holding each other accountable. I'm accountable to you, and you are accountable to me. In Hebrews 3, verse 12 and 13, it says, see to it, brothers, that none of you has a sinful, unbelieving heart that turns away from the loving God. So therefore, we are encouraging each other daily to stay the course, to stay on the battlefield. Because are the brothers and sisters that watch out over one another? Are we speaking into each other's lives? Are you speaking into each other's lives? It's not that I don't want to offend you, but do it in love. If you see each other slipping away, be bold enough, be courageous enough to say, hey, that's not who you are. God called you for greater. Don't forsake your first love. Don't get comfortable. God is doing a new thing in your life. God wants to use you. There is purpose and destiny upon your life. It's a new day. It's not me for me. And I don't care about anybody else. But if I see you drifting, I'm going to draw a little close to you and say, come on, get back in the race. Don't bow out. Be watchful. Stay on the wall. My God, stay on the wall. I'll pray for you and watch over you. Because I love you. I want you to hear, well done, thou good and thou good and faithful servant, and now depart from me. I know you're not. Stay on the battlefield, my God, my God, my God. Hallelujah. Stay on the battlefield. Be watchful. Pull up your socks this morning. Hallelujah. This morning, get some strength back to you. Be on guard and be alert. This morning, my God, my God. My God, the time has come. My God, for you to stay vigilant. Don't fall asleep. Stay on the firing line. Be watchful, be watchful. Be watchful and be ready, because God can put in his appearance at any time. He can put in his appearance at any time. I saw that in 2023. Many people just dropped out. And you're wondering, God, really? Really, God? I didn't expect that, God. Wish to show, be watchful. Be watchful and be ready. Not getting ready, but be ready. Be thee therefore ready at all times. Don't let the Lord come and you're not ready. Be watchful. Stay the course. The second command this morning is stand firm in the faith. This phrase, the faith, is doctrine. It's not just stand firm in your faith or in faith, but it's stand firm in the faith. Like I said, reading is fundamental. I'm learning that this year. I said, Lord, teach me. Reprogram me, Lord. As I begin to look at your word, I want to be reprogrammed to start seeing all the intricacies of the things that you are putting in your word for me to get it. So it's not just stand firm in your faith or in faith, but it's stand firm in the faith. And in this set of doctrines, these set of teachings that come from Scripture, from the Holy Spirit through the Bible, stand firm on doctrine. The centerpiece of Christian doctrine is Christ and Him crucified and resurrected. That's the core of everything. And Paul says in 1 Corinthians 2 and verse 2, I resolved to know nothing while I was with you, except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And he definitely would say, and resurrected. Christ crucified, Christ resurrected. That's the centerpiece of the gospel. We must stand firm in that. And the Greek word this morning for stand is sati. So it's like driving a stake into the ground. There is a solid pillar on which you build your life. It's not going anywhere. It's solid and secure. That is the doctrine of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's solid. It hasn't changed. It has not changed. We have changed. But the doctrine hasn't changed. It's the same. Yesterday, today, and in the future, it has not changed. So picture this. So as one of the parables says, dug deep down. Take the word of God and let it dig deep into your soul. So stand firm in the faith. It means you settle matters of Christian doctrine and never move from them, because it never changes. It's not going anywhere. And you build your entire life on them because it's not going anywhere. Jesus said in Matthew 7, 24 to 25, everyone who hears these words of mine and puts them into practice is like a wise man who built his house on the rock. And the rains come down and the streams rose and the winds blew and beat against that house. But it did not fall because it had its foundation foundation on the rock? Do you have your foundation on the rock this morning? The rock that cannot be moved, my God, this morning. And the opposite is building on sand. So as it's going to be destroyed, so building on Christ and on his word. And he's saying, and he's telling you, stay put here. Stay put on this. Don't drift off of this. Don't drift off of this. Stay put. Because I'm the rock. I'm not sand that's going to wash away. Stay put on me, the rock. Because I never change. I'm solid as a rock. Don't drift off of this. Stay on this. Stay on me. Because I'm not the sand, I'm the rock. The firm foundation. As Ephesians 4 and verse 14 says, we will no longer be infants tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and then by the cunning and craftings of men and their deceitful scheming. That's why not every pot is good to eat from. That's not why everything that blows, you're going to run to it. I think I mentioned something in Morning Manna. You're going to get, I can't even remember the term that Jamaican people used to say. Not every pot is good to eat from. Don't drift off of this. Stay put on the rock. Stay firm in the doctrine which God has placed before you, that has stood the test of time. So you are not blown around like children that don't know what the Lord is saying. We're solid, we're secure, we're standing firm in the faith. There's a firmness about the faith. And just because a new person blew into town and you run over there and now they're talking something that appeases you and your lifestyle, now you're thinking, that's gospel. No, it's not. Because if I'm your friend, I'm going to call a spade a spade. If you're living a hellish life, I'm going to tell you that you are. Because it's time for us to clean up our house and be honest about who we are and where we're going. I'm not doing you any favors to enable you. Because when I enable you, I'm putting up with what you're doing. And it's for your destruction and your demise. I'm going to date myself because I remember a movie in the 80s that was called Karate Kid. And it was Miyagi that was teaching this little kid. And the young teenage boy, which his name, I believe, was Daniel. And he brought him under his wings to teach him karate. And one of the most important lessons he taught him is a lesson of stability, of being stable on his feet. And he does this by bringing him to the California coastline. And he has him stand in stilts. And he made him stand in the steep surf water. And the surf is just pounding him while he does the karate kickstand. And the idea is learn how to balance and be strong on your feet. So as the winds and the waves came at him, he learned how to balance what he was doing in order to compete. So he takes him out into this little pond and he has him stand up on prows of that little boat. And it's kind of like wobbly, but he has to learn to balance. And he has to learn how to be stable as he positioned and takes that posture. And then at one point, he sees him on a pillar, like a pier kind of pillar, and a little short thing. And he's up on that thing learning to balance. The idea here is that we need stability. Satan is going to be waves upon waves and attacking us daily with our doctrinal life. New concepts is coming in that will challenge your doctrinal life, your Christianity, and your understanding of the doctrine. So in order to withstand it, you must be strong in the word. You need to drink from the word every single day. You must drink from the word every single day. You must be in the word every single day. Like I said, if you can't physically pick up the book, there's audio. There is no more excuses. We need to feed the soul in the word. We must stand firm in the faith. You must remain resolute in the season. I don't want to rush this, so there's going to be a part two next week where I talk about the other three. We've got to be resolute. We've got to be resolute. So the first was be watchful. And the second was stand firm in the faith. There's three more that we have to go through. The other day I was in a store. And a young lady came around the corner and I was there trying to look at something. And she said, I realized she was watching me. And because I'm looking out of my peripheral vision and I'm like, okay, all right. There's somebody here that's trying to get my attention. And I'm there pretending like I don't see her. And she's coming closer and closer. And as she got closer, then she said to me, "Hi, how are you doing?" I said, "I'm fine. How are you?" And so she said, "You know, I would love to invite you to a Bible studies." I said, "Oh, really?" So I let her talk, didn't introduce myself or anything that I am a pastor. Didn't do none of that. Because I was like, I wanted her to talk about what she's there to talk about. And so she's there saying yes. And she's like, we're a loving church and, blase, blase. And she was going on and on and on. And then she said, because we worship the Mother God. My eyes popped open. And she was like, yes, then Mother God. And that's what we focus in on in Bible studies. And, we're diving into the word because Mother God and blah, blah, blah. And I was like, whoa, okay. So I said, wow. And her demeanor, her approach was just so warm and welcoming. I mean, she immediately sucked me in, like just was sucking me in because she was just eloquent with her speech. And how she, and then there was another that came and joined. So she was on my left and the other was on my right. So they kind of sandwiched me into the middle and was just there talking. And they were, and then she said, well, we can come to your house and we can help with chores and we can do, so they have a little bit of the Mormon kind of feel to them. And she was like, but, as women, we have to just lock in because Mother God. And I was just like, I said, unfortunately, I will not be coming. I said, I'm a child of God and I subscribe to another doctrine and this is in conflict with what I believe. So no, I will not be participating in what you're asking today. Have a great day. And that's all I said. But can you imagine when we're not strong in our faith? We're led away. When we don't know what we believe, when we're not firm in what we believe, we're easily led astray. I want you to ponder on that for a moment. When you don't know what you believe, anyone can come and sell the whole book to you because you don't even know what's in the book. And regret is a terrible thing. Shoulda, woulda, coulda. We're all living a little semblance of that today in our own personal lives. or shoulda, woulda, coulda. If we had only listened, if I'd only made a better decision, that would have never happened. And the Lord is calling us to a higher place of praise and worship. He's saying, I give everybody the same thing. I place something in each and every one of us. I placed it in you, but you haven't tapped into it. I also hid all of my instructions to each of you in my word. But you failed to pick it up. You failed to turn the pages. We all kind of find ourselves priding each other on, I read that book and this book. I read Becoming so many times with Michelle Obama. I read this book and that book. Have you read the good book? Have you picked up the good book and read it? Wow. Ask yourself that question this morning. Have you read it? Do you know what it says concerning you? That's why you don't know you, because you don't know what it says concerning you. You don't know what it says concerning your father and how he loves you. You don't know what he says concerning the plans that he has for you. You don't know the blessings that he has in store for you. You don't know how he builds a protective edge all around you. And the enemy has to come to him and ask him for permission. You don't know how he gave up his only begotten son for you and I, so that we can be reconciled back onto the line. You don't know that he's coming back again. It's time for you to know what he says. Eat from his table and not every table that comes your way. Pull up the seat, because there's a seat for you and I at the table. And the word of God said the table is well spread. Everything is on the table. There is nothing lacking on the table. So if you seek him, you will find him. If you knock at the door, he will open it. And he will say, well, come on in. The doctrine is firm. It's solid. There is nothing missing from it. There is no ambiguity in it. If you just read it. If you just read it. That's why here at Recharge, we're beginning to read the Bible tomorrow. We got a yearly plan laid out. As I said, there's audio. No excuses. No excuses. Take the excuses off the table. When I do marriage counseling, my husband and I, we say divorce should never be on the table, because if you put it on the table, you're going to go for it. And it's because we have excuses after excuses on the table, we forever draw to it. That's why on a Sunday morning, what excuse do you have when there's digital? You can't even roll over and pick up the device and listen. God is creating means and ways to give us chances after chances to connect in. One of these days, we're going to come to the end of our journey. What will be the decision at that point? So in 2024, I go higher in God. I don't have time for the foolishness. I don't have time for the 100 things that are before me. I'm gonna settle in one. The rock of ages. I anchor my soul in him. Too much pot before us that we keep dabbling into. We eat here, there, and everywhere till confusion sets in. Settle in God. Be firm in God. Anchor in God. I'm not here to make you feel good. I'm here to disturb your spirit. I'm here to make you uncomfortable. I'm here to make you uncomfortable so you can do something about it. So you can pull up your socks. So you can hear, well done, my good and faithful servant. That's why I'm here. To disturb you, to push you into purpose, to push you towards God, because he does the joy. I'm here to deposit the seed so that the seed can grow and germinate in your life. I'm here to join in with what God is doing. So this morning, be watchful. Stand firm in the faith. Stand firm in the faith. That's the commands the Lord has laid out before us. And it's very clear. No ambiguity. There's three more to go through. Three more to go through. But the Lord is calling us to a higher place. 1 Corinthians 16, 13 to 14. Be watchful. Stand firm in the faith. Act like men. Be strong. Let all that you do be done in love. The latter three is what we will dive into next week. I pray that this word disrupted you today. To put you back on the right course. Cause you to recalibrate, recharge, refuel, re-energize, and bring you back to your first love. I pray that the hunger will be stirred up in you. I pray that the passion begin to bubble in your belly. I pray that fire will exude from you. I pray that you will run this race and run it well. I pray that you will endure to the end and know that he is God. Know that you are not alone, but he's there cheering you on and leading you through. I pray that you know that he's carrying you all the way when you get tired and when you get weary. But he's saying, stay the course. Endure, because I'm your firm foundation. Lord God Almighty, this morning, I thank you. I thank you for your word, Lord. I thank you for the reminders that you'll bring forward into our lives, Lord. As we're doing house cleaning, Lord God, this year, drawing close to you, Lord, because you are all that matters, Lord. It's not what the worldly desires are and what men say we ought to seek for, but it is you, Lord God, because you last forever and ever. The things that we are pursuing, Lord God, is just fading things. It's only for a season. But Lord God, you last a lifetime. And this morning, Lord God, we seek you like never before. Those, oh God, that need strengthening in their spirit this morning, Father, I pray that this word was sustenance and it brought forth a life into their soul this morning, Lord. I pray those that have been waffling and wavering, Lord, I pray this morning, Lord God, that they cease to wander, Lord God. And, oh Lord, a prodigal son and a daughter has come home, Lord, through your word, Lord God. And they have seen, Lord God, the errors of their ways, Lord, and how they need to remain and abide in you. So, Lord God Almighty, every person, Lord God, this morning, Lord, that's going through whatever journey,
Lord God, that they're on, Lord. I pray that they remain rooted and grounded in you, and they will seek you like never before, Lord God Almighty. I pray, Lord God, that we do not look to the left nor to the right, but we will turn our eyes, oh God, and look to you, Lord God, because you are the lifter, Lord God, this morning. You are the one that do all the drawing, Lord. And so as your word, Lord God, is sprinkled, Lord God, and soon, Lord God, you will draw men unto you this morning. You will draw women unto you this morning. You will draw your children unto you this morning, Lord, and you will feed them, Lord God, so they will thirst no more, Lord God, because you are the bread of life this morning. Lord God, you are the water, Lord God. Hallelujah. And as you pour out this morning, you're filling up vessels, Lord God, that's been thirsty and dry. And Lord God, as you pour in, Lord God, hallelujah, they will be renewed, Lord God. They will be revived and recharged for your glory. Lord God, the dry bones will live again. Lord God, hallelujah, the Lazarus are coming forward. They're hobbling out of their grave clothes this morning. Oh, because they heard the command to come forward. Come forth this morning, Lord God Almighty. Yes, I thank you. Your word is saying, come forth, come forth, come forth, Lord God, because you don't want to see any of us left behind or destroyed, Lord. So your word is going forth so that we can hear it, Lord God Almighty, and we can say, I yield, I yield, I yield this morning. So, Lord God, attend to every heart and every mind that will hear this word, oh God, today. Father, revive and restore their spirit this morning. Recharge and refuel them, Lord God. I thank you right now for what you are doing and what you are about, Lord God, because your word has been released. And I give you all the glory and all the praise and all of the honor. And I say amen and amen. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the blessed Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. I pray that this word this morning, hallelujah, remain rooted and grounded in you. This is Recharge Ministries, a place where the word is action, the logos is action, where we have a servant's heart. We are our brothers and sisters' keepers this morning. We're family-centered and where purpose must be fulfilled on your life and on my life this morning. God's purpose must be fulfilled in our lives. And I pray that you heard the word of the Lord today, and you have taken your part out of it. I've taken my part, hallelujah, this morning. So take your part today, and I pray that you seek him like never before. And those that need for us to pray for you, we're here to pray one for another. Amen. So I pray that you have an amazing Sunday in the Lord and be blessed, because God gets all the glory and all the praise and all of the honor. Amen and amen.